Good evening all. Today I'm here to discuss with you one of the most important and interesting concepts. But before going into the actual topic, I would like to show you one thing. Right. Just look at the slide here. So what do you see in the slide? So there are two pictures, and below the pictures it was written as Bharat Darshan and International Cultural Exchange, right? So have you ever heard about the programs of social welfare institutions like Bharat Darshan and International Cultural Exchange? Yeah, probably most of you might be knowing about these programs, right? But few may not know. Let me explain you about these programs in brief. As a part of this Bharat Darshan, the meritorious and the outstanding students will be selected and they will be given a chance for India tour. If you see the first picture, it is you can see the students were selected as a part of Bharat Darshan program and they went to Jaipur as a part of it. Clear? And just observe the second picture. So this picture was captured at Singapore and these students were selected as a part of this International Cultural Exchange program, and they were deputed to Tanglin International School, Singapore, to do internship. Right. So these are the two examples which I've taken. But if you see, have you ever thought like what would be the main intention of initiating all such kind of programs? Have you ever thought, have you ever got a question like that? Yeah. The main intention behind initiating all such kind of programs is to bring out all the hidden potentialities of the students and make the students to excel in all the fields. Right. So here, these programs like Bharat Darshan and ICE, these programs are acting as a motivators, right? So these motivators are creating a kind of stimulus, okay? So the stimulus is created within the students and the stimulus is pushing the students to reach their goal. Okay, here what is the goal of the students? To grab the opportunity and to be selected in these programs is the ultimate goal of the students, right? So in order to reach this goal, the stimulus is pushing the students, is altering the behavior of the students, is changing the behavior of the students, right? So the stimulus which is generated by these motivators is called as a motivation. Clear? Today, we are going to discuss the concept of motivation and the theory of motivation, that is the need hierarchy theory of motivation. Now, let us understand what actually the motivation means. Look at the slide here. The term motivation is derived from the Latin word mover, which means to move. To move in the sense, to move in a forward direction, that is from the present position to the desired position. And motivation refers to the motives in the action. So what are the motives here? Motives are the needs, wants, drives, desires, impulses within a person. So all these factors like needs, drives, desires, impulses are acting as a force within a person and making that person to move in a particular direction or to act in a particular way. Clear? In order to be more clearly understand the term motivation, we'll just look at the definition which was given by Fred Luthans. So according to Fred Luthans, motivation is a process that starts with physiological or psychological deficiency or need that activates behavior or a drive that is aimed at a goal or a incentive. So according to Luthans, The motivation is like a, is arises due to the deficiency. What is a deficiency? Deficiency is that which you do not have right now, the thing or a need which you do not have right now and which you have not satisfied yet, but you are desiring in order to satisfy them in the future. So that is a deficiency. So this need, deficiency, or any of the goal is altering your behavior, is activating your behavior, it is changing your behavior. Right, it is molding your behavior. So in order to reach this ultimate goal, a person behave in such a way which paves a path to reach his ultimate goal. Clear about the meaning of motivation? I hope you understood what actually the motivation is. And now let us see, there are many factors, which motivates a person. So generally, organization uses different factors in order to motivate its employees. So the most widely technique which is used by the organizations to motivate its employees is a 4P formula. Right. So this is a most widely used technique. Right. So under this 4P formula, we'll be having 4 P's. Okay. So and each P denotes one word. Let us see what is this 4P formula now. So the first P here indicates praise, right? So what is a praise here? Praise is nothing but an appreciation, like appreciating a person on the completion of a task or for the work done. Like a small token of appreciation, like you have done a very good job, keep it up, good job, well done. So all these words seems to be very small, right? But this will have a greater impact on the performance of the employees. So this praise or the appreciation motivates the employees a lot. Clear? And the second P here is the prestige. So what is a prestige? Prestige is nothing but a respect or recognition. So if the organization is respecting its employees or recognizing the work of employees, then that person feels very happy and feels that he is also a part of the organization and tries to work hard in order to fulfill the needs of the organization. So every organization have to respect its employees and recognize the work of employees in order to get the work done. Clear? And now the third P here is the promotion. Right? So promotion, what is a promotion? Promotion is nothing but placing a person from the lower position to the higher position and assigning him with a greater responsibilities. Right. So if a person is promoted from lower to higher position, he will automatically given a higher responsibilities. In order to maintain that standard, in order to reach that standard, the person always try to work hard. Right. And the last P under this 4P formula is a pay. What is the pay here? That employee will get some salary for what he is doing or for the work done. But here pay is nothing but a kind of incentive or increase in the salary or a perk which is given as a token of appreciation. Right. So here pay also plays a very important role in motivating a person. Now after looking, after understanding these 4 P's, we can categorize this 4 P's into 2 types. Clear? The first 2 P's were called as the non-monetary motivators. Right. So why these were called as the non-monetary motivators? Because we are not giving them any monetary benefits here. We are just appreciating them, or we are just giving respect to the employees, nothing more than that. So here there is no involvement of the monetary factor. So for that reason, we call it as a non-monetary motivators. And the next 2 P's, that is the promotion and the pay, are termed to be as a monetary motivators. Because here we are giving them a hike in the salary or a bonus or an incentive. Here we are giving them the monetary benefits. So for that reason, we call this as the monetary motivators. Clear about this 4P formula? Right. And now organizations, we have already discussed, like, the organizations are following few techniques to motivate its employees, right? Now, there are many methods used by the organizations to motivate its employees. So the important methods used by these organizations are the positive and the negative motivation, right? So these are the two types of motivations which not only the organizations but also everyone may use at one or the other point of time in order to motivate the employees or in order to motivate their colleagues or in order to motivate their students, whatever it is. So here, what is a positive motivation? Under this kind of positive motivation, the employer offers the employees a bonus or a gift. So here you have to differentiate between who is an employer and who is an employee. So employer and employee, right? Here the employer is a person who gives job to the employee, like who gives work to the employee, and in turn he pays salary to the employee. Okay, we can call him as a boss or the manager of the organization. Clear? And here, employee is a person who works for the organization, right? And he receives the salary from the employer. So he works for the organization and he receives the salary from his employer, right? Now you came to know who is an employer and who is an employee, right? So here, this employer is offering this his employee a gift or a reward on the completion of a task, on the completion of a work, right? Here, for example, the boss comes and announces in front of the employees, like, we have got a new project and this is very prestigious project for us. If you complete this project within a stipulated time of 10 days, then you will be given a reward, like your salary will be hiked, or you'll be given a bonus, or you will be given some perks. So all these factors, like hike in the salary and a reward or a bonus, is acting as a positive motivators upon the employees. Clear? So in order to get that reward, these employees try to complete the work within the stipulated time and get the reward. So they fulfill the task at last. And here, under this negative motivation, a fear or a force is created among the employees by the employer, right? So here the employee literally threatens the employees, like, we have got a new project. If you are unable to complete this project within 10 days, then you'll be terminated, or your salary would be deducted, right? Or you'll be demoted, right? All these factors are acting as a negative motivators on him. And actually, he's not willing to do the work, but in order to escape from all these negative consequences, like deduction of the salary or demotion and termination from the services, he is forced to do the work. Clear? So at last, somehow he tries to complete the work and escape from the negative consequences. Clear about this negative and positive and negative motivation? And here, the positive motivation is otherwise called as a reward motivation or an incentive motivation, and the negative motivation can be called as a force motivation or a fear motivation. Clear? And sometimes you may have noticed in your class also, your class teacher may either use the positive or the negative motivation in order to make you complete the task, right? Sometimes a teacher positively may say, like, you have to complete this assignment and have to submit it by tomorrow. If you submit this assignment by tomorrow, then you will be given a pen, you will be given a pen or a book as a reward. Clear? Sometimes she may use this negative motivation and she literally threatens you, like, if you are not going to complete this assignment by tomorrow and if you are not going to submit this assignment by tomorrow, then you will be punished. What would be the punishment? Generally, it is to write the same assignment for 20 or 30 times. Then, what do you think at that time? Like, what is the feeling of you? Internal feeling. I'm not asking you the external feeling. Externally, everyone will say, okay, madam, we will complete. Yes, ma'am, we will complete. But internally, what do you feel? Amma, it is better to write for one time and submit it to the teacher rather than to write for 20 times. Right? This is a feeling of you, inner feeling. But nothing is wrong in that. Every person wants to escape the negative consequences. It is a general human tendency of a person to avoid the negative consequences. So I hope you understood the techniques like 4P formula, which are used by the organizations, and the two methods, that is positive and negative motivation, which were used by the organizations or any other person in order to motivate its employees or the students. Now, let us discuss about the significance of the motivation. Just look at the slide here. So, motivation is an inner force that moves the people to work more, right? So it is a force which is created internally, and with that force, people will be pushed to do more work. Clear? And here, the motivation plays a very important role in determining the performance of the employees. Clear? So if you see a slide, you will be having a downward arrow, an arrow which is facing downward and an arrow which is facing upward, right? So the downward arrow here indicates low and the upward arrow here indicates high. Clear? So if the motivation is low, then obviously the performance of the employee will be low. And in contrast, if the motivation is high, then the performance of the employee will be high. Here you have to note, motivation is directly proportional to the performance level of the employees. So if the motivation is high, always the performance would be high. If the motivation is low, then always the performance will be low. So it is directly proportional to the performance of the employees. Here one must make a note that if anyone is motivating a person, then obviously his energy levels will be boosted up, okay, and he works more. And if a person is demotivating another person or degrading another person, then what happens? He feels very low and all his energy levels will become low. And though he is an efficient person, he couldn't able to do that work properly. So always try to motivate a person and never ever try to do demotivate anyone. Okay, remember this point. And so this is so far we have discussed about the meaning and the types of motivation and the techniques used by the organizations in order to motivate its employees, and also the significance of motivation. Now let us move on to the another important segment of our lecture, that is the theories of motivation. So just look at the slide once. Here the theories or the models of motivation are of two types. One is the content theory and the second one is the process theory. So if you look at the slide, you can clearly observe here, content theories focuses mostly on the what motivates people at work. Like the main concentration of this content theory is on what are the factors which are playing very important role on motivating a person at the workplace, right? And the one of the basic assumption of this content theories is that every person will have a same set of needs, right? For example, my set of needs, like I will be having a same set of needs, and the other person is also having a same set of needs, and you will be having a same set of needs. There is no deviation of the needs of a person from one to the another. So that is the basic assumption of this theory. And the theories propounded by Maslow, Greger, Herzberg and Alderfer are the important content theories here. And the second set of theory is the process theory. So process theories concentrates mostly on how does motivation occur. Like it concentrates on the process of motivation. Clear? So what is the process by which a person will be motivated is the main concern of this process theories. And here the basic assumption of this process theories is that every person will have a different set of needs. no two persons thinks in a same manner, and for that reason no two persons will have a same sort of needs. So my thought process will be different and your thought process will be obviously different. So we do not have a same sort of needs. So that is the basic assumption of this process theory, and this concentrates on the cognitive process, like what is the process involved in our thought process and why the needs of a person are different is the main concern of this process theories. And if you see the examples of this theory, these are the theories propounded by Victor Hume, Porter Lauer and Stacy Adams. Clear? So these are the two types of theories, and now we will go into one of the most interesting theory, that is the need hierarchy theory of motivation. Right? So this need hierarchy theory of motivation falls under the category of the content theories. So this is one of the basic theory and the fundamental theory of motivation. Just look at the slide here. The person who are seeing on the slide is Abraham Harold Maslow, and he was the one who propounded this theory. He was an American psychologist and behavioral scientist. He is called as the father of humanistic psychology because of his extensive studies on human motivation, and also he invented a term called as hierarchy of needs. So for that reason he is called as the father of humanistic psychology. And let us see the important works of Abraham Maslow. So the first one is A Theory of Human Motivation, which was published in 1943. So this is a classic paper in which Abraham Maslow discussed the need hierarchy theory of motivation. And the second important work is Motivation and Personality. This was published in 1954. And the third important work of Maslow is New Knowledge in Human Values. So these are some of the important and popular works of Abraham Maslow. And here, need hierarchy theory of motivation is based on one principle. So that principle is prepotency of needs. Clear? So the basic assumption of this theory is the prepotency of needs. What is the term prepotency denotes here? It is nothing but urgency of needs. Right. So urgency of needs means every person will have a different set of needs. Right. So I'll be having 4 or 5 needs at a time, and you will be having some 5 to 6 or 6 to 7 needs at a time. But here a person categorizes all his needs based on the importance. Right. Say for example, right now I'm very thirsty. Okay, this is one of my need. And I have another need, like I want to watch a movie. And next one is I want to go for a shopping, right? And the next one is I want to purchase few books. Clear? So out of these 4 needs, I'll categorize what all needs are important for me right now. Right now I'm feeling very thirsty, so satisfaction of my thirst is the basic need for me right now. So in order to satisfy my thirst, I need a glass of water. So I'll just drink a glass of water and be relaxed. So my basic need is satisfied here. Clear? And now I'll be having a 3 set of needs, right? And among these 3 needs, I will categorize which need is very important for me right now. Going for a movie is not that important, I'll keep it aside. And going for a shopping is also not that important for me, I'll just keep this aside. And purchasing books is very important for me, like I'm preparing for some exam and this is a very important need for me right now. So I will give most importance to this need. I try to satisfy this need first, right? So after satisfying this need, again I'll categorize these 2 needs into more important needs and less important needs. Clear? So this is how a person categorizes all his needs into more important needs and less important needs. Clear? So this is what is the concept of prepotency of needs. Clear about this? Yes. And now here Abraham Maslow classified the needs of a person into 5 kinds. If you look at the slide, you can understand clearly. So this is a hierarchy of needs which was propounded by Maslow, and in this theory he categorized all the 5 kind of needs and embedded all these needs in a pyramidical structure. the triangle structure which you are seeing is called as the hierarchy. And in this hierarchy, so this is a hierarchical structure, and in this hierarchy he categorized the needs into the following types. So the first order need here is the physiological need. Clear? So the physiological need is otherwise called as a basic need or a biological need. So this is one of the basic need without which a person cannot survive. So these are very important needs for the survival of the human beings. If you look at the slide, you can clearly understand. So food, water, air, sleep, sex, these are the basic needs of a person without which he cannot imagine his life. Clear? So this is from the general point of view, like a food, water, air, sleep, sex, etc. And from the organizational point of view, what would be the basic need here? Salary. Salary is the basic need from the organizational point of view. And this salary enables a person to have all the other kind of basic needs like food, shelter, clothing, etc. Clear? And the impact of this physiological needs is so strong on a person that if these needs are not satisfied, then there will be no room for the other set of needs. So, for example, you are hungry, right? If you are hungry, would you concentrate on reading or would you concentrate on writing an exam? No, first thing is that you have to satisfy your hunger. After satisfying your hunger only, you will think about all the other kind of needs. Am I right? Yes. So this is the physiological, this is about the physiological need. Yes, I have satisfied my physiological need. It's very good. And after satisfying this physiological need, a person thinks to satisfy his second order need. So what is the second order need here? It is the safety and or a security need, right? So look at the slide. This picture clearly depicts that safety is first, right? Safety is one of the first important need for the individual. So here the person seeks safety from the external threats, environmental threats, and threats from the unknown persons. And he wants safety and security for his family, and he also wants good health and safety and security for his health, and in turn he wants job safety also. So job safety is from the organizational point of view. Okay, if you observe the recent trends, so this is a corona pandemic situation where everyone are staying at their homes in order to be safe, and if it is mandatory for anyone to go out, they are taking all the precautionary measures like wearing a mask, using the sanitizers, etc., and maintaining physical distance, etc. So why they are following all these preventive measures? In order to be safe. Like, no person wants to take a risk. Everyone wants to be in a comfort zone, right? So from the organizational point of view, the safety needs would be safe working environment, clear, physical safety, and clear working procedures. So clear working procedures in order to avoid anxiety and stress. If the work procedures are not clear, then that employee will be in a confusion like what to do and what not to do, right? So this obviously creates some kind of stress, anxiety, tension among the persons, and this will have impact on his mental health. So in order to make the employees in a safe comfort zone, then the organization should follow these steps like clear working procedures, safe working environment, and so on. So after satisfying these two kind of needs, like a physiological needs and safety needs, a person tries to satisfy his social needs. So social needs are otherwise called as belongingness needs and love needs. Okay, look at the slide here. Here the person is craving for affectionate relationships from the family, from the spouse, from the relatives, from the friends, and from the children, right? And Aristotle rightly stated, a man is a social animal. He always craves for affectionate relationships, and he wants that love, affection, belongingness, a kind of friendship. He always wants to satisfy his belongingness needs. Okay, he wants someone to share his happiness and to share his sorrows, right? So the impact of the social needs is so strong on the individuals. Clear? If you observe the children from the broken families or the families where the children were deprived by the parents right from their childhood, then these kind of people will have a strong desire of satisfying this need. Okay, so after they grown up also, they'll think about satisfying this need and they'll give more importance to this social needs only, right? So from the organizational point of view, what would be the social needs here? So it is nothing but maintaining cordial relationship with his colleagues and also with his higher-ups. So with the colleagues, that person may develop informal relations, right? So informal relations are otherwise called as the grapevine relations. Okay, so these are the informal relations. And with the higher-ups, he maintains formal relations. So maintaining cordial relationships in the workplace enables a person to work more. Okay. And after satisfying this physiological needs, safety needs and social needs, one will move on to the other set of needs, that is esteem needs. Right. So the other name of this esteem needs is the ego needs. Right. And again, this esteem needs are classified into two types. That is achievement needs and recognition needs. Clear? Achievement needs are expressed in the terms of self-confidence, strength, right? And if these needs are satisfied, if this achievement needs are satisfied, then a person becomes strong and independent. And this recognition needs are expressed in the terms of recognition, respect, grabbing the attention of others, and in simple we can say he want to be a star in the crowd. Okay, so these are the achievement and the recognition needs of a person, and the impact of this needs will be so strong on a person. Like now we will see what are the organizational point of view. From the organizational point of view, here from the organizational point of view, the esteem needs would be giving some respect to him, giving a kind of status to him and recognizing his work. Okay, so these are from the organizational point of view. And the impact of these needs would be so strong and on the person. If these needs are satisfied, a person becomes strong, a person becomes self-confident and he becomes adequate and he becomes useful. Okay. Once if these needs are not satisfied, then what would be the consequences? He becomes weak, he becomes helpless, and a kind of inferiority complex will be developed among the person. So this is a very dangerous situation. So in order to high our self-esteem levels, we have to follow few steps. Look at the slide. Here, these are the steps to high your self-esteem needs. So what is the first step here? Forgive yourself for the past mistakes. So whatever has happened in the past, you just leave it. Past is past. You can't change your past, right? So future is in your hands. You can change your future. You can mold your future, right? So forgive your past mistakes and concentrate on the future. And the second step here is to focus on your positive attributes. So what is that attribute here? Attribute is nothing but the talents. Whatever the talents you have, you focus on that. Whatever the positive qualities, whatever the positive strengths you have, you just give time for the growth and development of these qualities. Clear? And the next step is follow the example of successful people. Just try to listen the inspirational stories of the successful people or try to read books of the successful people. Right. So if you want to become a good civil servant or an efficient administrator, then study the successful story, then go through the life story of our secretary. So that is Dr. Praveen Kumar, sir. So you, if you study the successful stories of that person, then you'll come to know what all hardships you have they have faced, and how they overcome these hardships, and how they stood in this position. You come to know everything, and you develop a sense of positive attitude. Clear? And the next step here is to become a self-talker. Right? What is a self-talker? Talking to oneself. Clear? So if you talk to yourself, then you'll begin to see the world in a positive way. Okay, remember one thing, we can't change the situations. Whatever happening around us, we can't change the situations. But only is in your hand is how you are reacting to it. So we can't change the situations, but we can control our reactions. So if you become a self-talker, then you will come to that position so that you can control your reactions and you can control your emotions to some extent. And the next one is exhibit a good attitude. What does here exhibiting a good attitude mean? Positive attitude. Just show positive attitude towards some people, right? So if you try to exhibit a good attitude, then automatically this makes you an optimistic person, right? And it avoids all the negative thoughts and sorrows. Clear? And this exhibiting a good attitude is a kind of mental state where you think, yeah, everything is fine, all is well. So that would be your attitude. If you go on exhibiting the good attitude, then you will develop that mindset. Clear? And next is practice your talents. So whatever the acquired talents or whatever the inherited talents you have, you just try to practice your talents. You have you just try to brush up all your talents. Okay, the next step here is to become physically and mentally fit. So this is very important. So if you become physically fit, then obviously you'll become very strong and you'll be in a position to do any kind of work. Clear? And mental fitness, what does this mental fitness mean? So it is not like we are training our brain for some mind Olympics or we are going for some IQ test. No, it is not like that. Mentally fit in the sense, controlling your emotions, right? Knowing clearly like where to burst out and where to control your emotions is what is the mental fitness. So in order to be strong, you have to develop that mental fitness and physical fitness. And the next step here is to learn new things. As this is a lockdown period, we got a plenty of time, right? So we can utilize this, can't we utilize this time for learning new things? Yes, of course we can. So try to learn new things, like try to learn new language, or try to learn cooking, or try to learn dancing or singing, whatever it is, whatever you have never done before, you just try to learn in this lockdown period. Clear? Next is to improve interpersonal relationships. So what are these interpersonal relationships? So maintaining the relationships either with your family or with your friends or with your colleagues, you have to maintain the relationships. In order to maintain these relationships, you have to become an active listener, right? And you have to develop a positive attitude towards the people. Clear? And you try to be empathetic towards others. So by following these three steps, you can maintain your personal relationships. And at last, dress well. So dressing well also makes a sense. If you have dressed well and someone gives you a compliment like you are looking great in this dress, then obviously you'll feel happy inside, and that enables the growth of self-confidence in you. That builds the self-confidence in you and it boosts up your attitude. Right. So by following these small steps, we can high our esteem levels. Clear about this? Then, then a person has satisfied his physiological needs, safety needs, social needs, and esteem needs. Now, what is the last kind of need which he wants to satisfy? It is the actualization need. So it is a self-actualization need. Clear? So the self-actualization, the term self-actualization was coined by Kurt Goldstein. Clear? So the term actualization was coined by Kurt Goldstein, and later it was extensively used by Abraham Maslow. Here, what is the meaning of self-actualization? So it is a new term, right? So what is the meaning of this term? Self-actualization is nothing but to be what you want to be. Okay? It is finding the true meaning of your life. It is developing your own potentialities, right? It is the self-fulfillment of yourself. Clear? So this is what is self-actualization. Right, from the organizational point of view, the self-actualization needs would be assigning challenging tasks to the employees, right, and giving them a chance for the growth and development. Clear? And a few researchers have said that only 2% of the people can reach this actualization stage, because it is very difficult for all the persons to reach this actualization stage, because every person will stuck up satisfying all these four needs. Okay, so they'll never find time to think about the self-actualization need. Though it is difficult, it is not impossible. It is possible. You can satisfy your actualization needs. Just by posing two questions to yourself, you can achieve the actualization stage. So the first question is, what is the true meaning of my life? And the second question is, for what I am here? If you can answer these two questions, then it is very easy for you to reach this actualization stage. Clear? So these are the five set of needs explained by Maslow. And again, this hierarchy is divided or categorized into three kinds. The first two needs, that is the safety and the physiological needs, these are called as the lower order needs. Clear? And the social needs, this is called as the middle order need. Okay, and the last two needs, that is actualization and esteem, these are called as the higher order needs. Clear? So the pyramidal structure is divided into three types, that is lower order needs, physiological and social safety needs are categorized as lower order needs, and the social need is categorized as the middle order need, and the esteem and the actualization need is categorized as the higher order need. Clear? Right. Now Maslow says that every person strives to satisfy his basic need first. Okay. After satisfying this basic need only, a person moves on to the safety or the security need. And after satisfying the safety need, he moves on to the social need. In a sequential process, it is like a sequential process, that is step-by-step manner. He tries to complete all his needs in a step-by-step manner. Clear? So this is about the need hierarchy theory. And now we'll discuss the features of this theory. Clear? So this just look at the slide once. So these are the features of the theory which were advocated by Abraham Maslow. So the four important features of this theory are: hierarchy is not rigid, and the second one is human being is a satisfaction seeking animal, and the third one is needs are seen, and the fourth feature is a satisfied need no longer motivates a person. Clear? So now we'll discuss the first need, first feature, that is hierarchy is not rigid. So according to Maslow, whatever we have discussed as a hierarchy and the needs which were embedded in the hierarchy, according to Maslow, it is not that rigid. It is not a watertight compartment. Clear? So we can interchange the needs, or we can adjust the needs according to our interest or according to our wish. Okay, say for example, I'm a person who doesn't give much importance to social needs, right? So soon after completion of my physiological needs and security needs, I can skip the social needs here and I can move directly to the esteem needs, right? After satisfying my esteem needs, and again I can come back and satisfy my social needs. So this is what he meant to say, like it is not rigid, it is a watertight compartment, and we have that flexibility to exchange the needs. Clear? And the second feature here is human equal to seek satisfaction. So that's what you are seeing on the slide, right? It means that a human being is a satisfaction seeking animal, right? Always a man wants pleasure, not pressure, right? If one need is satisfied, then he tries to satisfy other set of need, and if that need is also satisfied, then another need pops up and he tries to satisfy that need. So this is a never ending quest, Right. A need will be arised, and after the satisfaction of this need, again there will be another need, and a man will be behind satisfying all these kind of the needs till the end of his life. So it is a never-ending process. It is a never-ending quest, and always human beings want satisfaction. Clear. And the third feature here is needs are same. As we already discussed in the beginning of this lecture itself, like content theory's basic assumption is each and every person will have a same set of the needs. So that was the basic assumption of this content theory, right? So here Maslow also explains the same thing. Needs are same. Every person will have a same set of needs. There is no deviation of the needs. Clear. And the fourth feature here is satisfied need, no motivation. It means that a satisfied need no longer motivates a person. Once my need is satisfied, then that need is not going to motivate me further. To be more clear, I'll give you one example. Say I'm working in an organization, right? So my manager or my boss announces that this year the outstanding employee would be given a car. That might be a Maruti Suzuki or whatever it is. So I do not have a car, and I'll be motivated for that car. I work very hard, I work extensively and prove to be the best employee of that particular year, and at last I'll get the car as a reward. Okay, so my need of having a car is satisfied finally. Okay, and the manager next year also comes with the same proposal. This year the outstanding employee will be given a car. Then this time that car is not motivating me, because having a car, that need was satisfied last year. Then why that car next year again motivates me? No, it won't motivate me further. So here you have to understand that once a need is satisfied, then it no longer motivates a person. Even for you also, if one of your need is satisfied, you observe that need will no longer motivates you. Then another new need, which is unsatisfied one, that will motivate you more. Clear? So these are the features of this theory. Now let us see the criticism. Every theory will have a criticism, and this theory is also not an exemption from criticism. So this theory was criticized mainly on four grounds. Clear? So the first ground of criticism is the validity of research data. Okay, so this till date there is no practical experimentation which was conducted on this theory. So this theory is basically based on the assumptions of Abraham Maslow. So we do not have any relevant data in order to prove this theory. So for this reason, some scholars have criticized this theory on the validity of research data. And the second point of criticism is concept of self-actualization. So the concept of self-actualization, which we have discussed, is not clear, and it is indefinite, and it is vague according to some scholars. So Maslow failed to explain the concept of self-actualization in a clear manner, right? And the third criticism here is culture bond. Okay, so this theory has its roots in the Western culture. So this theory was developed in America, that is USA, and most of the scholars were in an opinion that this theory, we can't apply this theory universally, because there are some features like basic needs and safety needs which can be applicable universally, but there are some features we can't apply universally. So that was one criticism. And the last one is the concept of entire hierarchy was criticized, because the scholars were in the opinion we can't embed the needs of a person just in a hierarchy. So the needs are not that simple as explained by Abraham Maslow. So the needs are very messy, right? So according to the scholars, the entire concept of hierarchy is not correct in order to embed the needs of a person, in order to explain the needs of a person. So this is about the criticism of Maslow's need hierarchy theory. So we'll just have a quick glance of what we have discussed so far. Okay, so we have discussed the meaning of motivation, definition of motivation, significance of motivation, types of motivation. Under the types, we have discussed positive and negative motivation, and the theory of motivation. Like we have divided the theories into two types, content theories and the process theories. And we discussed the need hierarchy theory of motivation. Under that, we clearly came to know about the five set of needs, that is physiological needs, safety needs, social needs, esteem needs, and actualization needs. And at last, we discuss the features of this theory and the criticism of this theory. Clear? And though this theory was criticized, like despite this criticism, this theory led further researchers in the field of human motivation. Clear? This theory provided a way for us for our self-improvement, personal development, and growth. By this theory, we came to know what are the needs of a person actually have and what are the things we have to do in order to satisfy our needs. Clear? Before winding up of this session, we'll just discuss about the questions which we can expect from the PG entrance point of view or from any other competitive examinations. Look at the slide here. Who is regarded as the father of humanistic psychology? So it was Abraham Maslow. We have options like Douglas McGregor, Abraham Maslow, Alderfer, Harold Kelly. So it is Abraham Maslow who propounded this, who is called as the father of humanistic psychology. And if you see the second question, who coined the term self-actualization? So now you can say the answer easily, like it is Kurt Goldstein. But at the time of your examinations, you may get confused, because the concept of self-actualization was associated with Abraham Maslow. Then you will blindly mark the answer as Maslow. But you have to remember, the term was coined by Kurt Goldstein and later it was extensively used by Abraham Maslow. And next, these two are the subjective type of questions. We can expect these questions for civil's mains point of view. So those who have opted public administration as their optional, they can expect these questions. So what is the first question? Need hierarchy is rigid and limited. Critically comment. Okay, so you have to critically examine this theory and you have to write an answer for this. And what is the second question here? Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs and Herzberg's two-factor theory have commonalities. Comment. Right, you have to compare here the theory of Abraham Maslow and the theory of Frederick Herzberg. After that, you have to write an essay about this. Like, what are the similarities of this theory and what are the differences you have to write. Clear? So, your assignment is just try to write answers for these two questions. Like, need hierarchy theory is rigid and limited, comment. And next is the commonalities of Herzberg's two-factor theory and Maslow's need hierarchy theory. So, this is class for today. And I'll be looking forward to meet you again. Thank you so much.